So a new version has been released of the Affinity software suite, which is my go-to photo editor as well as publishing tools and drawing and so forth. And a lot of people are really feeling like maybe this update isn't actually worth paying for and could be a little bit of a cash grab on the part of Serif who make the software. And so I actually purchased it. I'm gonna give you a little review of all of the new features, let you know whether I think that it is worth buying or not.
I think that this is an excellent lens.
Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel. My name is Emma and professionally I'm a software developer, but in my free time I love landscape photography and making related videos here on YouTube. Today I want to take a look at Affinity version 2 and hopefully answer some of the questions that you might have about the update. I'll go over the new features, let you know what I like and dislike, and get into whether I think that it is worth buying the upgrade if you already have version 1. Before I get too far, let me give a very quick introduction to the Affinity software suite for anyone who might not be familiar. If you have watched my photo editing videos before, you're probably familiar with Affinity Photo, which is my go-to editing software. And I actually use that in conjunction with Affinity Designer and Affinity Publisher, the other two pieces of the suite, to make a lot of the things that you see in my videos, like the chapter slides and the thumbnails. Affinity Photo is, of course, a photo editing software and is probably of most interest to my viewers. It's generally considered to be a Photoshop alternative, and it's good for developing your camera's RAW files or for more advanced tasks like erasing unwanted objects or compositing. Affinity Designer is a vector drawing tool and is a competitor to Adobe Illustrator. Affinity Publisher is a publishing software for making page layouts and can be compared to Adobe InDesign. It also pulls in the tools from the other two applications if you own them so that you can create graphics and edit photos directly on your page without having to switch applications. Now, one of the draws of Affinity is that it is sold as a one-time payment and allows you to own the application forever rather than, say, Adobe's subscription model. When Affinity Photo was released while I was in college, I didn't have the money to pay for a subscription, so I started using it as a Photoshop alternative while it was actually still in beta, and I've been using it ever since without any complaints. The parent company, Serif, said at the time that future updates could require payments, and here we are 7 years later with the release of Affinity version 2, which has been released as a new application for purchase. Now, if you own version 1, you can keep using it. It won't get any new updates, but it is very stable, so that shouldn't be a problem anytime soon. But I want to look at some of the reasons you might want to upgrade. I'm going to focus mainly on Affinity Photo because this is a photography channel. And let's just spin around here to the computer and get a little bit of a hands-on look at some of the new features. The first thing that I want to show you is that we now have non-destructive RAW edits in Affinity Photo version 2. Previously, Affinity Photo was a really great tool for developing your RAW files, but once you actually clicked the develop button, all of those edits were locked in and you were sort of stuck with them. So I've got a RAW file pulled up here in Affinity Photo version 1. Now suppose that I were developing this RAW file and I were to accidentally overexpose it. So I've blown everything out and I've clicked develop, and then it processes all of that, and then I realize, shoot, I messed up, I overexposed it. Now, at this point, I could maybe add an adjustment over here, put in a new adjustment layer, and try to start bringing the exposure back down using an adjustment layer. But at this point, I'm making adjustments over adjustments, and it's really just kind of baked in. I don't have the option so much to go back. Depending on my settings, I, at this point, also don't really have access to the full data in that RAW file. And so there's not really a lot that I can do, and I would probably just want to start over on developing this. If I were to switch over here, though, to Affinity Photo version 2, And now I were to make the same intentional mistake and overdevelop my RAW file, what I can do is I can switch from the default option of pixel layer for the output, that's what was always the only option in the past, to a RAW layer embedded. And when I do that, it's going to actually keep the RAW file embedded inside of this Affinity Photo file. So if I click develop, now I've overexposed this, obviously, but what I can do is I can actually either click on the develop persona again or just double click on that layer, and it takes me right back to those develop options. And so I could go over and just correct my exposure as well as make any additional changes that I might have wanted or wished I had made, and then hit develop again. And as many times as I develop it, I can close the file, save it, and come back to it later, whatever. I can keep on coming back and redeveloping that original RAW file. That is just a really huge improvement for people who work with those camera RAW files to be able to work on them again later. If you maybe want to walk away and come back and take another look at it, or maybe have walked away, you thought that you were done, but you come back later and you decide there's something that you think you could do a little bit better job on, all of those things. There's many times when you might want to just redevelop your file, and now you have that option. You can also, once you've set it to the raw embedded option for the output, it will remember that in the future, so you don't have to remember to change that each time. It's set and forget, and once you've done it the first time, your file sizes will probably be a little bit bigger, but you'll be able to take advantage of all of that later on. Another great new feature that we have in Affinity Photo 2 is some new masking options. Now, I love to apply edits to different portions of my photo using masks rather than applying them to the whole photo. In the past, though, I've always just done that by brushing on the mask manually. But now in version 2, we have the option to make luminosity range, hue range, or these band pass masks. And so just to give you an example of that, let me show you a luminosity range mask. Say I wanted to make some adjustments to this photo that I didn't want to apply to the whole thing. Maybe, for example, I would like to add a little bit of saturation to the highlights. I think that could look good. So I can add a bunch of saturation here. That would be a little dramatic, actually, so that it's easy to see. And that's applied across the entire image. But now if I added a luminosity range mask onto that layer, it works just like the curves adjustment, and I could pull down the shadows in, or I could pull down the highlights in. And when I do that, you'll see, like, if I turn the shadow side off, now this applies just in the highlights. I could actually add points along here as well if I wanted to increase the amount in the midtones. And that makes it really easy to apply an adjustment layer just to a specific portion of the image. I can also take a brush if I want, actually, and brush on or off specific parts of that, so I can brush a portion of it off just to refine things a little bit further. Other photo editors like Lightroom have had these types of masks for a long time, so it is nice to finally see them being added to Affinity Photo.
Now, on that note, I want to transition to a few things that I don't really like or that I think are missing from this update. First of all, I do want to mention the new UI. You probably noticed there are a lot of new icons that are a bit muted and just don't really stand out and apart from one another as much as they did in the last version. I know that that is the way that design is going, and as I've used the app for a while, I've gotten used to the icons, but at first it did feel like it was a bit harder to find my tools. Beyond that, I would have liked to see some more powerful new features in a new version and just haven't. For example, things like HDR merges and tone mapping were not originally in version 1, as I recall, and were added later through updates. When making the move to a paid upgrade for version 2, I would want to see something on that level added to the application to set version 2 apart. For example, if we had some new things like AI image upscaling and AI masking, tools that other applications do offer, I think that it would be more clear that this is really a new version worth paying for. With UI updates and a couple useful but not complex features, I think a lot of people are wondering if they should upgrade or stick with version 1. So, should you upgrade? I think the best way to decide that is to go over to the website and download the trial of version 2, use it a bit, and see for yourself whether you think it's worth it. You can run the new version right alongside the old version, and it's not going to mess up any of your existing setup. And if you do decide to purchase it, you won't have to re-download anything. It will pull the license from your account. So, what are a few reasons that you might not want to purchase the new version? Well, if you don't want to spend the money for the upgrade, especially if the new features don't sound that useful to you, then I just wouldn't worry about it. If you are satisfied with version 1, it's very stable, and I would expect everything to work there for a long time to come. So why might you want to upgrade? Well, there are some new features, as I showed you in Affinity Photo. There are other new features there and in the other apps. And so if those are useful to you, that could be a reason, as well as to get future updates, which I'm sure will come with new features later on. At the time of filming, you can also get version 2 for 40% off, which is a great deal. I'll put the prices on the screen for you guys. To me, it feels a little bit like a pre-order. I like the new features, but I'm also expecting that there are going to be good things in future updates, although I don't know what those will be. Speaking of that pricing, that's another reason why you might want to purchase version 2. If you have just some of the apps right now, there is a bundle price to buy all of the Windows, Mac, and iPad apps all at one price, which saves you a bit of money. And you can install those on all of your devices. So if you have like a desktop, a laptop, and an iPad, you can install it everywhere. Plus, one last thing, there is Affinity Publisher for the iPad now. So if you use Publisher and wish you could use it on the go, you'll need to get version 2 of at least the iPad apps. Overall, I would say that Affinity version 2 as it stands right now is pretty similar to the last version. I went ahead and bought it now just to treat myself a bit because I've been saving a lot for moving lately to get those new features and to get Publisher for the iPad, and largely also to buy in now at the discounted price with the expectation of getting good updates in the future as I've seen in version 1. I do highly recommend the Affinity software suite. I think it's really good value for money. So if you're still watching and you're considering it for the first time, definitely check it out. That is all for this video. Hopefully it answered some of your questions, but if there's anything else that you would like to know, please feel free to leave a comment under the video. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to hit the like button on your way out and to subscribe to my channel so you don't miss more videos that I'm really excited to share with you in the future. As always, thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next one.